The next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him. They began to shout, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, "Do not be afraid, people of Zion. Look, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." John 12:12-15.
Good morning, church family. Would you stand as we worship the Lord together on this Palm Sunday? We sing, "Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you." Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, and hope is stirring, and hearts are yearning for you. Oh, we long for you. When we see him, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Sing Hosanna.
kids so much. Can we just share our love to the kiddos one more time? Love y'all. Y'all are awesome. I love it. So, so good. So, so good. And y'all can have a seat. We are so thankful that you're here. We are thankful that on this Sunday that we can reflect and remember and celebrate Palm Sunday. It's the Sunday really where all the world is reminded of the truth, the historical fact of the sacrificial death and the glorious resurrection of King Jesus. And so we are so thankful that you're here, so thankful that we could even be reminded through song and through our youngest hearts this morning of King Jesus and his love for us. And so thankful that you're here. Welcome, welcome. We are so thankful that you're here. We want to especially anyone who's maybe here for the very first time for our 10:45 worship service, we're so thankful you're here and hope you feel right at home. And at the end of our service, in just a little while, right out in the foyer, we have a little gift we would love to give you at a place called Guest Central. We'd love the opportunity to just say hello. And so thankful again to worship alongside you. And this week really is a very special week for the world, but also specifically for believers as we reflect on the significance of what happened on Palm Sunday. Is that this is love. This is amazing love. This is amazing grace that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that we reflect on Christ making that final entry before the cross into Jerusalem, and that he would lay down his life and take our place so that we could be forgiven, so that we could be free. So excited to celebrate that. And I would just say, this week, as we approach this week, we have some really unique opportunities that I would love to invite you and that we would be inviting others to two special opportunities. One is Good Friday. This Friday, we are going to have a really unique worship experience at 6:30 p.m. Our choir has been preparing all semester and even into this new year on really just bringing God-glorifying music. We're going to walk through the Word. We're going to have some very, we're going to have a special time of walking through different elements of Good Friday and the significance of those and the significance they have on our life. And so would love for you to come. We're going to have childcare for all the preschoolers. And it's going to be a really, really powerful time of worship, I believe, with all my heart. And so I don't know what your Friday looks like, but I would encourage you, if you would carve out Friday night at 6:30 and join us for a really, really powerful time of worship. And then into Easter Sunday, we'll have two identical services, one at 8 and one at 10:45. Again, they'll look just alike. And then after the 10:45, we're going to have an Easter egg hunt in our Grove area right after service for all of our preschool through fifth graders. It's going to be a sweet, sweet time. And so excited. So as you came in, you might have sat on one of these, or maybe you picked one up. Every seat had one of these in it, and it's an inviter card. And here's what I would ask if you would join me. There are different seasons of the year where it seems like folks maybe are even more inclined to accept an invitation to church. And so I would ask you to take this invitation and make it a point of prayer that you would ask and seek the Lord, who is it, whether it's a friend, a coworker, a family member, who is it that you could personally extend an invitation to come and celebrate Easter with you? And then not only that, but that there are maybe a few seats around you. Pick those cards up. We have more cards that are out in the foyer area. But just making that intentional effort about praying who the Lord would desire us to reach out to and to bring with us. And so I want to pray for us just as we get started. Excited to continue in song. Excited to walk through the Word today. And always excited to share life together as a family of faith. And so as we do this, I want us to pray, but I want to give even just a moment that maybe even holding this inviter card, that maybe we would just take a few moments and just seek the Lord and just ask the question, Lord, who is in my circle? Who is in my life that you would desire me to bring with me next Sunday. So let's pray, and then I'll pray for us in just a moment. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. This is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Father, we come together as a family of faith, Father, to worship you and to seek you and to grow together, learn together, share life with one another. And Father, I thank you especially for this Palm Sunday. Father, that we reflect intentionally on your amazing love and amazing grace. That, Father, you came to make a way for us to be forgiven, a way for us to be made right with you, a way for us to have peace with you, a way for us to have true rest in you. And, Father God, that you have come that we may have life and have life to the full. And so, Father, all of that is only possible through a life-giving personal relationship with you. God, we give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. God, I pray that for your church, God, as we go out into our communities where we live, work, and play, and God, I pray for divine appointments. I pray, Father, that you would give us eyes to see those who are hurting, those in need of hope, those in need of a family, God, that you would use us to point others to you. Give us boldness, give us courage. But God, I do pray even now as we continue in this time of worship that our focus would be on you. Our focus would be turned to heaven. And Father, that you would have our heart's attention, that you would be glorified, and that you would work in a mighty, mighty way. So God, thank you for this opportunity to worship you together. We love you. We honor you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand as we continue to worship the Lord this morning, church? Your grace close.
Rumors of the Son of Man, stories of the Savior, holiness with human hands, treasure for the traitor. No ear had heard, no eye had seen.
My saving grace. You're my hope.
Amen. Let's just sing that chorus. Let our voices carry that chorus one last time. You are worthy.
You are worthy. You are worthy of your name. You are worthy. You are worthy of your name, Jesus.
Amen, amen. Let's give him praise this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to worship you here this morning, Lord. Thank you so much for being faithful to us each and every moment of each and every day. Thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us, Lord. We are so excited to celebrate this holy week beginning today. The triumphal entry, Lord, you know, and you knew, excuse me, you knew what your mission was. And you knew that come Friday, there would be pain, there'd be tears, there'd be agony. Or even Thursday night, you would sweat drops of blood thinking about us and thinking about how you would endure the cross for us. Lord, thank you so much for that sacrifice you made. But ultimately, we get to celebrate and have joy because Sunday, you rose from the grave. And that is a reason to say amen and amen and amen over and over again. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity to praise you for who you are. Thank you so much for giving us the breath in our lungs this morning to even be able to sing, to be able to speak about you. And Lord, now as we dive into your word, would you just prepare our hearts for these next few moments? Lord, thank you so much for the ability to dive into your word now. I pray that it would transform us from the inside out, each and every one in this room. We ask this in your holy name. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you so much, team. And if you have your Bibles, I invite you to join me in the Old Testament book of Joshua. Joshua, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua. We are continuing our journey through God's story. We began the new year with Genesis 1, and we are continuing through the Word. And this morning we are in Joshua chapter 1, and our theme this morning is getting over overwhelmed. Getting over overwhelmed. Just a quick question. Nobody knew it in the first service, but just a quick poll. Does anybody know the name David Spathanky? David Spathanky. And I think I'm saying it right. So, David Spathanky. He also goes by the name The Great DeVito. The Great DeVito, which, by the way, Pastor David James, he might be the maybe DeVito James after this. But anybody? Okay, I'm going to show a photograph of this gentleman and what he does. He is a plate spinner. Matter of fact, the great DeVito, he holds the Guinness World Record for the spinning 108 plates simultaneously. He holds that record. He did that on a TV show in Bangkok, Thailand in 1996. 108 plates spinning at one time. That is amazing. It has been said that the only way to figure out how many plates you can spin is to break some. So I don't know how many plates were broken in that attempt, but I don't know if anybody in this room has ever gone for spinning plates. But it is very possible that your life has felt like that picture sometimes, right? Spinning plates. That there's all these things that we need to be done. We feel the weight, we feel the responsibility to keep everything going, to keep everything spinning, and to make sure nothing falls. That there are days when we feel like we're spinning a bunch of plates. There are weeks that we feel like we're spinning a bunch of plates. There are months that we feel like we're spinning a bunch of plates. There are even seasons where we feel like we are spinning a bunch of plates, and we're just hoping none of the plates fall. And so whether you have been there recently, whether you are there even right now, this feeling of being overwhelmed with all of the different things that come our way, that we feel like life at times maybe is bringing on a little bit more at us than we feel like we are able to maybe even handle at some moments. And so as we think about this idea of being overwhelmed and getting overwhelmed, I want us to look to the book of Joshua this morning. As we open the book of Joshua chapter 1, we are moving out of what was the Exodus era, and we are moving into the conquest era. And we're looking at a very significant moment in the life of the nation of Israel, God's people, and a very significant moment in the life of Joshua specifically. Because now in Joshua 1, the people of God are on the east side of the Jordan. Once again, they are back after 40 years of wandering, after the event known as the rebellion. That the wandering season has passed, and now they are back again on the brink of the promised land. And under the leadership, at least up to this point of the east side of the Jordan, Moses has been their leader. We wrapped up the book of Deuteronomy last week, and we know that Deuteronomy is like Moses' last word of speech to his people. And he's 120 years old when he's given that last bit of instruction. And all the people of Israel have known is Moses and his leadership over them and with them. And so now here's a new generation. A new generation. It's a new generation because the previous generation have passed away in the wilderness. I mentioned an event known as the rebellion. This is where God led his people to a place called Kadesh Barnea. They're on the edge of the promised land. They sent 12 spies in. 10 came back with a fearful report. That fear spread like a contagious disease. All of the people were fearful of the giants in the land. And they rebelled, they turned against God, they didn't trust God and his promise to give them that land. And as a result of their rebellion and they're not trusting God and they're turning from God, then everyone 20 years and older in the nation of Israel would pass away in that time of wilderness. Only Joshua and Caleb would be the survivors from that great rebellion because they were the only two that stood to trust God and trust his promises. And so again, I mentioned we're going to look at this significant moment. And Joshua is facing a lot. He's facing a lot. And I want to be real careful, just two things. One, that as we look to this word, and we will look specifically at Joshua, I do want to just always be clear. Joshua, though we will learn much from his life, is not the hero of this story. God is always the hero. He's always the hero. And for Joshua, I don't know if he's feeling overwhelmed in Joshua 1 where we're reading, but what I do know is all of the opportunity is before him to be overwhelmed. And so as we look to this passage, here's a truth that I pray will be extremely comforting to you and to us, and we see it in the Word. And the main idea is this: God will provide every spiritual resource needed to accomplish his purposes. That God will provide every spiritual resource needed to accomplish his purposes for your life and for my life. That this is true for our lives today, as true as it was for Joshua thousands of years ago. And so as we go into Joshua 1, Joshua is somewhere around the age of 79. Don't know exactly how old he is, but he's somewhere around, he's probably in his late 70s. And so if he's in his late 70s, if you do the math, that means if you were to go back and look at Joshua's life, Joshua was there in Egypt when he experienced personally the harsh slavery of Pharaoh. Like, he woke up, he lived that, he experienced that. He had a front row to the great plagues that we read about, the outstretched arm of the Lord revealing his might and his power against wickedness. Joshua had a front row seat. He saw it all right before his eyes. Joshua was there and with his family when he experienced the first ever Passover. And if you recall the Passover, this was just at the just before the 10th plague. The 10th plague would be the death of the firstborn of the family. And God would bring this plague in judgment on a wicked nation. But God gave his people instruction. He said, if you will take a lamb without spot or without blemish, and you will slaughter the lamb, and you will take the blood of the spotless lamb, and you will place the blood on the doorposts and lintels of the home, that when God comes bringing judgment on the wicked, that he will pass over your home. He will pass his judgment over you. And the significance of that Passover lamb was that the Passover lamb was the substitute for the firstborn of the family. And so for Joshua, guess what? Joshua was the firstborn of his family. And so for him especially, when they took the Passover lamb, he understood this lamb was taking my place. He understood that. He was there walking across the Red Sea when it parted. He was there at Sinai. He was there at the first military battle. He became a military general in that first battle against the Amalekites, God bringing them victory. He was one of the two spies that came back and saw everything the other saw. He saw the giants. He saw all of the fortified cities. But for him, all he needed was God's promise. And that was good enough for him. And him and Caleb were like, let's go. That in that wilderness wandering, I mentioned every Israelite age 20 and older passed away in the wilderness. That would break down to about 80 people a day that would pass away in the wilderness as they were walking through. You think about that daily reminder that the wages of sin and rebellion is death. Joshua experienced all of that. And so now again, as we are entering into Joshua chapter 1, a significant moment and transition is happening in his life. Let's look at Joshua chapter 1, verse 1, the Bible says this. It says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, the son of Nun, and I say Nun because he wasn't the son of a nun. I say that you read the way you read it, he was the son of Nun, and he was Moses' assistant. And in verse 2, the Bible says, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the people of Israel. All right? Now as we read this, this is a lot. There's a lot that's happening in that short verse. If you think about it, Deuteronomy, as we wrap up, we know Moses passes away, and there was a 30-day mourning period for Moses. And so that mourning period has just wrapped up, and now God is calling Joshua to arise. But I can't help but think Joshua is probably still wrestling with the loss of Moses. Like, again, Moses was 120. He was the only leader that they knew. And yet, everywhere he turned probably is like this, Moses used to do that, or Moses always did that. There's these reminders, and it's almost like aftershocks of processing the loss that Moses is no longer physically with them. But God says, arise. And he says to go over the Jordan. Now here's what's interesting with there. We'll learn if we were to keep tracking through Joshua by Joshua 3. We understand that this is a unique season in the year because it's flood stage for the Jordan River. In other words, when the river seems maybe manageable, it is not manageable at this moment. And God is saying, arise. I actually have a map. I want to just to have a visual of kind of how the Jordan is set up. I hope you can see it. I know the letters are kind of small there, but basically the Jordan River begins north of even that picture in a place called Mount Hermon. And the Jordan River begins there and flows into that first larger body of water you see at the top of the picture. That's the Sea of Galilee. And then if you follow the Jordan, it picks back up at the south end of the Sea of Galilee and runs about 60 miles and empties into the Dead Sea. Now, this river is significant in the Bible. It's mentioned like 200 times in the Bible. And we'll see it even throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament, as we walk through the Word. And so this river, if you can see those bottom two green dots, those are, one is Jerusalem, one's Jericho. And we know that Joshua and the people are camped on the east side of the Jordan, and they are across from Jericho. And as we read Joshua 1, this is where they're at. Now, the river would serve as like a boundary for the land of Canaan to the west, that is along the side of the Mediterranean, and then all of the other lands of the east. And so this is like a boundary for the Canaanites who are currently in the land. In their mind, they're thinking we're golden. They're scared of the Israelites. They've heard the report. They've heard the mighty acts of God. But it's flood season, so at least they have a buffer, because there's no way. There's no way they can make it across the Jordan, especially during flood season. And so I want us to think about this for Joshua. Moses has passed. God is calling him to arise. He's saying, go over the Jordan. He doesn't have any details yet on how that's going to happen, but the Jordan is at flood stage. Verse 2, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people. Who are all this people? It's at the very lowest number, 1 million people. Some scholars have said it could be as many as 4 million people. So when he's saying you and all this people, he's saying you and bottom number, 1 million people. You're going to lead this people. That is a lot of plates. I mean, just think about the weight and the responsibility that is all before Joshua. The state of Mississippi has 2.9 million people in it, the whole state. This is the nation of Israel. And so as we look to this, there is all kinds of opportunities for Joshua to become very overwhelmed with the weight of the responsibility that is before him and all that he's processing. Like as we read it, it makes you want to go online to Verbo and book like a retreat for some R&R just before he gets in there and begins to lead them. But what we all know is this: we never get a break from responsibility. We never get a break. We can have times of respite and things like that, but we're never not responsible. And that responsibility really is a gift. And it's a stewardship, because it causes us to turn on the Lord, to turn to the Lord, and to depend on His strength. And so God is going to mentor Joshua. Again, Moses has passed. The Jordan's at flood stage, and you're going to be the one to go over it. You and all of this people, 1 million plus people, and God is going to mentor him. Let's look at Joshua 1:1 again. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the people of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, just as I promised to Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, to the great sea, toward the going down of the sun, shall be your territory. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you or forsake you. This is God mentoring Joshua in a moment where there is all kinds of opportunity to be extremely overwhelmed. And I don't know, but I'm thinking there's probably folks in the room that we can all relate to the moments where life just seems to bring to you what feels like maybe more than you can handle. So what does that look like? How does that work in our lives? And God is going to mentor Joshua, and God is going to mentor us through the word this morning. And so when faced with overwhelming circumstances, we must remember, first of all, God's presence. God's presence. Did you see in verse 5, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you or forsake you. Such a comforting promise. That yes, God manifested His presence in the Old Testament with His people through the tabernacle. But Moses had a really special relationship with God. And God is going to have a special relationship with Joshua. And as we see this, we see Moses, the 120-year-old leader that is now with the Lord. In Exodus chapter 33, verse 15, listen to what Moses says in the wilderness. He says this from Mount Sinai. He says to God, "If your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up from here." Which is powerful because it teaches me that for Moses, what was more important than anything was God's presence with him. That for Moses, he would rather dwell in a wilderness with God than to dwell in the most luscious of territories apart from God. Like, the presence of God is the blessing. If we look toward the New Testament, Jesus Christ comes. What does He do? God clothing Himself in flesh, dwelling among us. His name, Emmanuel, God with us. John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God. The Word clothed Himself in flesh and dwelt among us. That word dwelt is tabernacled. Jesus is God with His people. He's tabernacling with His people. But not only that, but Jesus promises to His people that I am with you to the end of the age. How? Through the presence of the Holy Spirit. God with us. This is how God is encouraging Joshua. And I believe how we as believers can be encouraged today is that even when we feel overwhelmed, and even when we think another plate can't be added, and even when we feel like we are completely alone, the encouragement is that God is with us. And that's the first thing God reminds Joshua. Just as I was with Moses, so I am with you. And so as we continue to look at this comforting truth, that God moves from His presence to reminding Moses of His promise. In verse 6, the Bible says, "Be strong and courageous, for you shall cause this people to inherit the land that I swore to their fathers to give them." In other words, I know that Moses has passed away. I know the Jordan is at flood stage. I know you're leading a million people, but I want you to remember I'm with you, and I want you to know that I will cause the people to inherit this land because I swore it to them. In other words, God is a promise-keeping God. When God makes a promise, He is faithful to fulfill that promise. This promise was rooted from centuries ago in the patriarchal era when God called out Moses, chose him, and called him to step out in faith and to enter into that land of Canaan. And in Genesis 12, God told Abraham, "This land I will give you." It's a promise. And God is faithful. He made His promise. He was going to keep it. And in this significant moment where there's all kinds of opportunities to be overwhelmed, God is reminding him, "I will fulfill the promise that I gave you. I'm with you, and I will see it through." And the scripture are filled with wonderful promises for His children. And in moments like these, in moments like ours when we walk through this, it's good to be reminded of that. I love Philippians 1, verse 6. Now, Paul, in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul wrote to a church, and he wrote this in Philippians 1, 6. He said, "And I am sure of this." And I just want to say, there's not a whole lot we're sure of in this world. Seems like a lot of things are out of our control that we would love to have control over. But there's one thing Paul says, I'm sure of. I am sure of this. He says, I am sure that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Christ Jesus. In other words, Paul is saying, listen, I know there's a lot of crazy things in this world, but here's what I am absolutely sure of. God will finish the work that he started in you and through you. Incredible promise. And so I say to my friends this morning, if you are facing overwhelming circumstances, may we listen to the divine mentor, God to Joshua. Remember his presence. Remember his promises. And the third is remember his power. Now he had just said it in verse 6, and he says it again in verse 7, and he's going to say it again at the end of the chapter. Only, verse 7, only be strong and very courageous. That God is mentoring Joshua. I'm with you. I'm going to fulfill my purpose. And my purpose is based on my presence. It's based on my character. I made this promise. I will keep it. And in that, there is a strength and there is a courage that comes. If you think 40 years ago from this moment that we're reading, I mentioned Joshua was a part of that initial scoping out of the land, the 12 spies, and only him and one other stood to trust God. And it looked like they were standing all alone, but they weren't. God was with them. I was reading a story about a guy named William Tyndale. He's the one who helped translate most of the Bible into English. And he lived in the 1500s. He was a martyr for Jesus. His death was him being strangled at a stake and then burned. And here's what William Tyndale said, and I love this quote. He said, "Christ is with us until the world's end. Therefore, let his little flock be bold." Isn't that strong? It just makes you want to charge a mountain. When you hear that God is with us, this is what God is telling Joshua. I'm with you. My promise is true. My power, I will strengthen you. And then we also see God's precepts. A precept is any commandment or instruction from the Lord that he has given to us for our good and for us to follow him in. Verse 7, Joshua 1 says, "Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to do according to the law Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may have good success wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success." This is such a essential principle to see in the Word, is that there is no relationship with God apart from the Word of God. That for God to Joshua, he is letting him know, listen, you want to experience that success and that blessing, my blessing over your life, you understand it's my Word. You tethering yourself to the Word, every area of your life. So in other words, in our lives, there's no design to be like, there's no design to be a room in our heart that's off limits for God. In other words, God, you can have this, you can have this, you can have this, but God, you can't have this. No, every area of our lives, our friendships, our work ethic, our marriages, our parenting, like the whole thing is to be intertwined with the Word of God. How many of y'all have ever played tetherball? Anybody play tetherball? It's a good time. Right, you got this pole, ball's on a string, all right? And the whole goal is you're just hitting that ball and you're just trying to get it over the other person and then get wrapped around that pole. And I want you to have that picture of that tetherball wrapped around the pole. And that's the picture of our lives being tethered to the Word of God. Like just saturated in the Word of God. I love what King David said in Psalm 119:93. He said, I will never forget your precepts, for by them you have given me life. There's life in the Word, and this is what God is encouraging Joshua with. That every area of our lives would be informed by the Word. Every area. Verse 9, God says, have I not commanded you? It's like he's repeating himself. Be strong and courageous. There it is again. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. There is so much opportunity when we find ourselves before overwhelming circumstances to allow our hearts to be dismayed. But God is reminding, he's mentoring Joshua. So when we face those overwhelming circumstances, may we remember, like God told Joshua, remember, I'm with you. Remember, I promised I will fulfill what I promised you, that you will have a strength and a courage because I'm with you, and cling to the Word and allow in those circumstances this reassurance and this peace that comes in that. But if we're all honest, I think as believers, we would latch a hold of that and be like, amen, that's right, I believe that, I know that's true. But then what do I do? Like, then what happens? And what we see if we follow this mentoring session with Joshua, what we see is by God's grace, when faced with overwhelming circumstances, Joshua did the next right thing. He did the next right thing. That when we see him in verse 10, the next picture we see is from this mentoring session, Joshua is taking a step toward his commanders. And in verse 10, Joshua commanded the officers of the people, pass through the midst of the camp and command the people, prepare your provisions, for within 3 days you are to pass over this Jordan to go in to take possession of the land that the Lord your God is giving you. Joshua did the next right thing. What do I do? I don't want to know what to do. He did the next right thing. Moses isn't here anymore. Do the next right thing. The Jordan River is at flood stage. The commander's telling that word. Did you notice? He still doesn't know how he's going to get over it. God hasn't given him that yet, but he gave him the light for the next step, and he gave light for the next conversation. And so he follows through. Yes, I know there's a million people. That's a lot of plates. Do the next right thing. And for him, that next step was having that conversation with his officers. And so what do you do when you're overwhelmed and you do the next right thing? What do you do after that? You do the next right thing. You do the next right thing. Verse 12, now Joshua is moving from the offers to three tribes, or two and a half tribes, really. In verse 12, the Bible says, and to the Reubenites, the Gadites, and the half tribe of Manasseh, Joshua said, remember the sword that Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord your God is providing you a place of rest and will give you this land. Your wives, your little ones, and your livestock shall remain in the land that Moses gave you beyond the Jordan. But all the men of valor among you shall pass over armed before your brothers and shall help you until the Lord gives rest to your brothers as he has said to you, as he has to you, and they also take possession of the land that the Lord your God is giving them. Then you shall return to the land of your possession and shall possess it, the land that Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you beyond the Jordan toward the sunrise. He had the next conversation. He took the next step. Now, we don't have time to run after a rabbit right here, but just a little heads up. There were 2.5 tribes, we just read about them, that before this moment in Joshua 1, prior to Moses passing, that these tribes went to Moses and they made a proposal that because of the land on this east side of the Jordan where they were at, that they desire to stay there instead of going into the land of promise. Now, I'm going to be honest. That just blows my mind. Like, I don't understand that. Why in the world would you leave yourself one decision away from experiencing God's very best for you? But you know what? God allowed them to. They went to Moses. Moses sought the Lord. God allowed them to continue this land. Now, they're going to have to go and fight. But after they fight and conquer the land, they're going to come back. And God's going to allow them. God's going to allow them to live outside of His very best. But they are one decision away, to which I can't help but make that principle to our lives. And that how many of us are one decision away from giving God everything in our lives? Those steps and areas of obedience that He is worthy of, and that we find ourselves settling for less than God's best, less than God's design. And there's a multitude of ways that that can play out in our lives. But for them, they were at peace with remaining on that side, and God allowed them to do it, and they missed out, and it grieves my heart. And so I would say to us, is there an area of your life? You know, last week, I loved it. So the past 2 weeks, we've celebrated baptism in this service. And so this morning at our 8 a.m., we showed those baptisms at our 8 o'clock service. And with that, it's always encouraging to see believers take that step of obedience into baptism. Baptism doesn't save you. But baptism is the way you identify your life with Jesus. It's an act of obedience. And it could be that there is that step, like just taking that step to experience God's best. You know His design, you know His plan, and yet God. And so, but there are multiple ways that can play out in our lives. And so, may we not settle for less than God's best. Make that decision, take that step of faith. And so what did Joshua do in the face of overwhelming circumstances? He did the next right thing. And we may not be able to see it all. Maybe like you, I found myself this week wondering, how in the world is all of this going to pan out? And yet God gives the grace and the light for the next step. And then He gives grace and light for the next step. God help us to take the next step. A third and final observation is that when we're facing overwhelming circumstances, that we would remember that by His grace, we would put one foot in front of the next. One of my senior adult buddies in the 8 a.m. service, oftentimes he'll whisper in my ear, he'll say, remember, right, left, right, left, right, left. In other words, one foot in front of the next. One foot in front of the next. That's what Joshua did by God's grace. One foot in front of the next. Trusting God will provide every spiritual resource needed to accomplish His purposes. We never have to wonder. We never have to wonder if God will leave us or forsake us. He is with us and He's faithful. But here's one more observation, and I love this. God gives great encouragement through His people. God gives great encouragement through His people. You see, God didn't just call Joshua to enter into the promised land all by himself. There was a family of faith. And as oftentimes stiff-necked as they were and rebellious as they were or imperfect as they were, right? Joshua was far from perfect as well. A bunch of imperfect people living on mission for God and for the glory of God. And yet God brings great encouragement. Look at verse 16. The Bible says this, and they answered Joshua, all that you have commanded us, we will do. So remember, he's talking to those 2.5 tribes. He's charging them to be faithful to the promise that they made to God and God made to them. And so he says, all that you have commanded us, they say to Moses, or excuse me, to Joshua, we will do. And wherever you send us, we will go. Just as we obeyed Moses in all things, so we will obey you. Only may the Lord your God be with you. And as He was with Moses, whoever rebels against your commandment and disobeys your words, whatever you command him shall be put to death. I just got to hang on just a second. That's strong. That is a strong commitment from the team. And they are ready to take ground for God. They know this is His purpose to give them this land. They will not let another opportunity pass them by. They know God is faithful and He will lead them. And here they are talking to their new leader, Joshua. They're like, if anybody doesn't follow you following God, they need to be put to death. But then here's the last couple words of chapter 1 that I want to land on right here. I love this. Only be strong and courageous. We're hearing it again. It's like an echo. Only be strong and courageous. A people, a family of faith committed to living on glory, for the glory of God, on mission for God. And here's what I love. God used His people to say the same thing to Joshua in public as God had told him in private. Isn't that awesome? Like, they weren't spurred along. Like, God had this divine mentoring session with God. Only be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. My presence, my promise, the precepts, power, like the whole thing. And then here He is in the charge of His people and the love of His people. And here they are speaking the same thing back into His life. Only be strong and courageous. And I just wonder if Joshua didn't have this like, all right, God, I needed that. I hear that. I needed to hear that. How many of us, I wonder, have known the right thing to do and know the right thing to say, and we know it, God says it in His Word, we get it, we believe it, we hold on to it, and yet we still find ourselves struggling, but yet a brother or sister in our faith family, as we come alongside them and they come alongside us, they speak the truth of God into our lives. And it's the same thing that God taught us in His Word. Why? Because God's Word is the only thing that will guide us, give us life, as King David said, and rightly order our steps. And so I love that community around Joshua. And so I would just say, if you are feeling overwhelmed, and you feel like you are wrestling with, I don't know what to do because this person isn't with me anymore. Or you struggle because you look at the Jordan before you and you're like, okay, this isn't the size the Jordan normally is. It's flood stage right now. I have no idea how I'm going to get across that thing. I have no clue. I feel like I got a million plates and they're all really, really important and I don't know what to do. May we remember, and may by God's grace we put one foot in front of the next, and He's going to be faithful, and that as we do, we connect our lives with a family of faith to walk alongside and to speak the truth of God into our lives, and we will find great, great encouragement. I was talking to my sister earlier this week, and she's a teacher with a cooperative homeschool type mix. Anyway, she teaches, and I was talking. I was like, so how's it going? She said, I love it. My sister, she gets excited at times, and she's like, I love it. And here's the words, and I quote, it's so life-giving. Like, that's her words. And so I had to ask the follow-up, what's so life-giving about it? It sounds kind of hard. You know, like, what's life-giving? She said, the community of believers that she serves with, because they are bonded and connected and they're walking through this together. Not just the school stuff, but the life stuff. And so you see that life-giving gift of community. And so my encouragement would be, if you have not connected your lives with the family of faith, if you've not connected your life with men as other brothers in the faith to walk alongside you, and ladies in the faith to walk alongside. We need that. And that was a great source of encouragement. So I'm going to pray for us. And as we walk out, you know, I did just praise the Lord and reflect on Palm Sunday. And I think back, even in the context of Joshua, Joshua was the leader. Joshua was the one that would lead the people into the land of promise, into victory, and to conquest, and all of those things, and rest, Canaan rest. And as we look to the New Testament, Joshua was no Jesus. He was a very imperfect and flawed man, just like all of us could relate with. But in a lot of ways, Jesus is like a Joshua to us in that as we follow him and trust him and place our faith in him and yield in the Lord Jesus in his word, what happens is he leads us into the only place for true rest, the only place of true peace, the only place for lasting life, and that is through a relationship with him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the gift of today. God, I thank you for just this message, this passage in the scripture, this message to us from your word. God, I don't know. Joshua sounds like a very courageous, very strong, very equipped, skilled leader. But yet in all of that, you needed to speak those words into his life. And they're such great words for all of us to hear. And so, God, if we do find ourselves in the place of being and feeling overwhelmed, I imagine that there are probably many people in this room right now that are there. They're on that symbolic east side of the Jordan. And so, God, I pray that even through the word today, we would be stirred and inspired to trust you. We may not know how it's all going to work out. We may not know how we're going to get across the Jordan, but we know you're going to get us there and you're going to carry us over. And you're going to give us grace to put one foot in front of the next and obey you in the next right thing. And then you'll give us the light. I'm reminded that the word is a lamp into our feet and a light into our path. It's not a spotlight that shows the whole thing, but there's always light for the next step. God, help us to be obedient to the next step. And God, I pray, Father, that the overwhelmed would find great comfort in you. You are faithful, and you will provide every spiritual resource that is needed, that you will fulfill and accomplish your purposes and your plan through us. And that gives great rest. That gives great rest. And Father, I pray that if there's anyone here that is living outside of that rest, outside of a relationship with you, God, that they would be overwhelmed today with the fact that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. God, you came, you made a way where there was no way. And so I pray that perhaps today is the day of salvation, turning from self and sin, turning to Jesus, his perfect life, his substitutionary death, his glorious resurrection. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. God, I pray for salvation over the lost. And God, I thank you that there is no person that is outside the reach of your grace. God, thank you for being God. Thank you for loving us. We give you glory and honor and praise. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. I invite you to stand with me. We're going to have a song of response. We'll have pastors here who would love to pray over you. We're with you. And I encourage, just even in this time, maybe you're there, and we would turn our eyes to heaven and know where our help comes from. Our help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Let's worship.
Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Trust and obey, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
You can have a seat for just a second. As we close, I just want to remind you that just like Pastor Jared was talking about, we want to help you take that next step in the Lord. And maybe that's joining our faith family. Maybe that's salvation. Maybe that's getting involved in a small group here. Whatever that looks like for you, there's ways to do that. You can go to our Next Steps Hub and fill out that form, and we can contact you. We'll also be down here, down front, when the service is over. Also at that Next Steps Hub, there's ways to sign up for everything that's going on here at the church. Also, if this is your first time to worship with us, our pastor and his wife would love to meet you. And they've got a gift for you just to say thank you for being here with us. And they'll be just through these back doors to the left at Guest Central. And like I said, they would just love to meet you and shake your hand and give you a free gift and just say thank you for joining us today. And then lastly, if you're prepared to give today, there are giving stations in the front foyer and over by the information center, little black boxes that you can give that way, or you can also give online or via text, and those ways are on the screen. Lastly, we've got a ton of these cards, more than what's out here and even out there. And so if you want to give them invite in high volume, you're welcome to do that too. Just let me know. I got a bunch of them in the office. One thing my kids do is take them to school and invite their friends. And so seriously, I've got probably 500-600 more that we can resource you with. So really, if you want some, let me know and we can get you a resource. But use that and invite. You never know what an invitation may do to someone's life and maybe to generations to come. So as we close, Tony Caldwell will close us in prayer.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you for your presence in our lives, for your Holy Spirit. Father, thank you. Or help us to not only say the words thank you, but to live our lives every day in this constant state of thanks, knowing that what we have and what we are came from you. Father, thank you for this church, for this staff. Father, I pray that we will not only be thankful to you for them, but Father, thankful to them. Let them know we love them and we appreciate them, and we're here for them to support them. Father, I pray that you'll keep us safe as we depart. Bring us back safely, Lord, and help us to glorify you in everything that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.